Let's go back this way.
Thank you.
tuned in.
Happy Easter. Feel free to stand if you'd like. We're going to spend some time in worship singing together. Feel free to sing along if you'd like.
Okay.
God, we just thank you for this beautiful snowy day. We thank you for the opportunity to be with friends and family in this space, and just pray that this music can be a place of rest and peace, and that we can connect with you in a sweet way today. We give it all to you.
Thank you.
Free to have a seat. Hello, friends. My name is Greta. I'm one of the pastors here at the Commons. I've been gone for like the last month, so it feels really good to be back here with you all. Charlie's probably going to do this, so maybe I'm going to steal his thunder, but I feel like on Easter you have to say, I'm going to say he is risen, and then you can say he is risen indeed. That's just a church thing. You don't have to do it if you don't want to. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yes, woo, way to go. I'm going to start with a little communal prayer, and we love kind of getting to unite our voices, not only in song, but sometimes in words like this call and response style prayer. So if you would like to, feel free to read along as we do this. The words will be up on the screen. We have seen the resurrection power of Christ in our world today, when chains are broken and prisoners go free. Christ is risen. When children are heard, loved, and respected, Christ is risen among us. When weapons are destroyed and violence ceases, Christ is risen among us. When every person of every gender, sexuality, dress, and presentation is welcome in all things, Christ is risen among us. When all bodies are safe, whether weak or strong, Christ is risen among us. When all emotions are welcome and communication is open, Christ is risen among us. When access is available to all abilities and no one is excluded, Christ is risen among us. When the oppressed are liberated and teach us the way, Christ is risen among us. May it be so. I'm also going to share some announcements with us today of what we have coming up this next month. Tomorrow is April already, which is blowing my mind a little bit, but we have some fun events coming up indeed. The first one is we have lots of different interest groups. Some of them are for our young adults dinners. Some of them are our LGBTQ group. Some of them are men's nights and women's nights and anybody nights. We have all the things. But one that's coming up next week on April 11th is a men's whiskey night. And of course, our non-binary friends are welcome to that also. That's going to be on Thursday, April 11th at Blaine's house. So if you enjoy
meeting friends and sipping on a little whiskey. You don't have to sip on whiskey if you don't want to. It's just a really sweet time to hang and get to know people. So if you'd like some information about that, feel free to sign up on our little info sheet back there and we can send you all the details. But that's coming up on April 11th at 7:30 at Blaine's House is our men's whiskey night. And we also have on Saturday, April 13th, our community yoga class. So it's just a free yoga class. Anyone is welcome. We do it right here at Federated in Reese Hall, which is their big dining hall down the way. And that's going to be, 10 a.m. on a Saturday, just 1 hour class. All levels are welcome. Bring a mat. A lot of times we go out and grab lunch or a smoothie afterwards. So if you are into that, come talk to me after service, and I'd love to add you to our little contact list for our yogi folks if you're interested in that. Also, we're planning a fun event on Friday, April 26th. This is going to be more of a ladies' night. Of course, our non-binary friends are welcome. And this is going to be at my house, actually. I'm just going to host a little ladies' party. And there's going to be charcuterie. It's kind of like bring your own charcuterie item to add to the spread. And we're going to have just some food and drinks and hang out together. And we're also going to do some bracelet making. I know, it's like teenagers. I'm here for it. So come hang at that if you'd like on April 26th at 6:30 p.m. Awesome. So those are my announcements for you. But we, this morning, we went out to Lake Mary and followed our tradition of doing baptisms out at Lake Mary on Easter morning. And we weren't sure if we were going to be able to do it today. We thought we might have to cancel. But the two people who were getting baptized were really hardcore and wanted to do it in the snow. So we went out there and we did it and we caught a little footage and wanted to share it with you. So here it is.
Welcome, everybody. I was getting whispered in my ears, was it frigid in the water? And the answer is no, because I am 100% man. It was warm and toasty. And I was inspired by Asher and Ivan because they were both so brave, and it was so fun. It was such a beautiful morning, but you got ripped off because I went back after there and did a bunch of drone footage to mix into this video. And then I came here and got some drone footage of Federated in the snow. And then I let it do an auto zoom out thing because I thought it'd be cool. And it got stuck in the top of this tallest tree. So my drone and really excellent footage is just right outside the ceiling, right there. And I want you to know it would have been emotional. Like, it would have changed your Easter. But it's, I don't know, hopefully I'll get it down. If any of you have any ideas how to get to the top of a 100-foot tree, talk to me afterwards. That'd be great. It actually happened once before, and my brother and I actually had to use guns out in the forest and shot a branch off about, like, 100 feet up, which is America. Yeah, that's a thing. And I we'll talk more about that later, so hold that thought. Hey, I love that you're here, especially if you're visiting for the first time. We hope that you feel so, so, so welcome. We, more than anything, we're just a group of people, and we want you to feel really, really safe and welcome here. We have always, from the beginning, about 15 years ago-ish, once we started, prayed for other churches in town to celebrate the diversity of the movement of following Jesus in this community and around the world. And we have often, over the years, prayed for Mountaintop Assembly, and my good friend Jackie Holgate, who is a Navajo pastor who grew up in Navajo Mountain. But they actually started a little campus church of Mountaintop Assembly in Kayenta, and I saw on social media that they had a sunrise service in Kayenta. So I thought it'd be fun to pray for Mountaintop Assembly of Kayenta. So if you're the praying type, join me, and we're going to pray for them. God, we're grateful for an ancient holiday. We're grateful that a couple billion people are in some form or fashion thinking and resonating with the same ideas today. We're thankful for all the diverse churches in the world and hope that they are shining your light and love. And Lord, we're praying today and thinking specifically of Mountaintop Assembly in Kayenta. Thank you for Jackie, and thank you for Lenore, and thank you for all that they do here. But I just pray that that Kayenta community will find light and love and liberation and hope. And God, we also pray today as we join these billions of Christians reading these ancient stories, would you open our hearts and minds in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I love Arizona. My unpopular opinion is I love the snow. Even when it's late like this, I can't get enough of it. And everywhere I go, everybody's like, oh, I'm so tired, I'm over it. And all of you are just weak, and you weren't meant for the mountains. We are mountain people, and we love the snow. And I just, going down to Phoenix yesterday for track with Colt and Blaze went with me, it was crazy trying to keep sunscreen on them so that they're not burned. And then you run up the hill, and it's just a blizzard. And I'm just like, I love Arizona. I love it so much. And this is the first ever that I know of snowy Easter. I mean, we've had late snows bigger than this and even later than this, but I don't know if this ever landed on Easter. I was asking Kyle, he's a local boy, he doesn't remember it happening. Any of you ancient locals that go back even farther, come to let me know afterwards if we've ever had an actual snowy Easter day. I thought it was really, really a beautiful thing. If you haven't been with us, we're finishing a Lenten season on Easter. Easter is a feast. It's a celebration. It's the end of a 40-day plus weekends fast in the church calendar, and it is probably the biggest party of the year for Christians around the globe. And I was thinking yesterday, I'm a somewhat reflective person, probably like most of you, and I'm coaching pole vault at Flag High, and I often have these moments when I'm coaching pole vault where I'm going, why are we doing this? This is one of the weirdest sports you can possibly imagine. Like, who thought of grabbing a pole and seeing how high you could jump and then make it a sport and then made it a fiberglass pole and bent it and turned it upside down? Have you ever seen pole vault? Have you ever wondered why on earth people are doing that? Do you have that moment all the time in life? And you can just look around a track and field event and you go, oh, triple jump. That makes sense. Hop, skip, and a jump. Let's see how far we can hop, skip, and jump. That's really cute and fun. I think it's weird to think about all things in this sort of childlike way. And I thought today it might be behoove us to think of Easter in that way. Why do we do this? I mean, as a pastor for several years, I find it interesting that we do the same things. It was so refreshing to me to have a blizzard this morning because our sunrise service felt a little bit different today. And it was beautiful and fun. But again, I was thinking, why do we do this? Why do we pole vault? Why do we triple jump? Why do we have religion? Why do we have services? And what I want to do today is I want to take you on a risky journey, if you will. I grew up celebrating the cross of Christ and resurrection my whole life, and I think we've already been on a little bit of a risky journey if you've been with us talking about atheism for Lent. We've been taking the risk for several weeks at looking at some of the greatest atheist thinkers, not to critique them, but to agree with them, to understand what they're right about when they say there's no God, because they're right about a lot of things. And we've been, in essence, giving up God. And when I grew up, Easter was explained to me in very simple terms. It was about my individual salvation. It was something to do with me being a sinner and Jesus dying on the cross and paying for my sins. And if I believe that, or if I maybe asked Jesus in my heart or believed the right thing, or specifically if I believed that Jesus resurrected from the dead, then I would go to heaven forever. And some of you are going, yeah, that's Christianity, right? That was the Christianity I knew. I want to challenge that today. I want to challenge you to understand that that's a very modern, late individualistic American understanding of an ancient faith that our ancestors passed down to us. And I think it's wrong. Now, what I'm not saying is there's not hope of heaven and resurrection and life and redemption and forgiveness. These are all beautiful words, but they have been co-opted by a particular form of religion that I believe has become the antithesis of Christianity. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to read to you the story following Palm Sunday, where we left off last Sunday. I'm going to read you just a tiny little snippet from the death of Christ on the cross on Good Friday. This is the pastor's greatest challenge, by the way. Easter Sunday, you've got to cover like all of the theology of Christianity in just like a few minutes. And so it's kind of like more than ever drinking from a fire hydrant. But I'm going to try to keep it as concise as possible to take us to this radical idea. And I want you to lean in and hear this phrase, the death of God. There's no more appropriate ending to atheism for Lent than the death of God. So I hope you're nervous. I hope you feel a little weird. And I hope it takes us somewhere. Let's go to Matthew chapter 27. This is one of the most infamous moments in the life of Christ. I'm going to cut through all the gory details, and I'm sorry if we all have different religious backgrounds. You may not have much information at all on how Jesus of Nazareth ended up getting killed, but basically, he ticked off the people in power. One of the things that keeps me coming back into buildings like this and in communities like this and being a part of conversations about Jesus of Nazareth is Jesus of Nazareth did not mind to shred and critique and cause a whole lot of discomfort for religious leaders. And when he rode into town on a donkey in a nonviolent way, weeping in a non-toxically masculine way, knowing what sort of destruction was coming to Jerusalem when Rome was going to crush them, and when he went into town and saw religious leaders who had turned religion into a profit capitalistic gain and overturned their tables in a very active resistance movement without hurting anybody, but with a very, very resistance movement of turning over tables and driving out money changers and challenging the system, he started to tick off powerful people. And everybody there wanted him to be powerful himself. Instead, he wept. Instead, he washed feet like a servant. Instead, he followed his own teachings of turn the other cheek to the extreme level of facing the death penalty. Jesus was absolutely no moron. Jesus was highly aware of the complex political systems of Rome and the Jewish religion that he was a part of as a rabbi. He understood when he walked around town and saw these Roman crucifixions happen. These Romans had developed a death penalty that was among top 10 all time of how to torture somebody for mass effect to stop people from behaving in a way you don't want to. And so he walked around and he saw would-be messiahs up on crosses. And he knew when he overturned those tables, and he knew when he spoke against the religious leaders, and when he spoke against empire and the system, that at the end of the day, he was going to end up on one of those crosses. And that's exactly what happened to him. His religion betrayed him. Roman empire squished him. He found himself on a cross. Here's what it says at the very end when he's hanging from this torture death penalty device. From noon until 3 p.m, darkness came over all the land. And about 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" This is probably, arguably, one of the darkest, most poetic utterances of an influential human in the history of mankind. How could the teacher, the rabbi, who taught about the kingdom of heaven, how could the one who said, if you've seen the Father, you've seen me, how could the one who taught us that the kingdom is for children and for the oppressed, how could the one who showed us the face of God say this poetic line, my God, why have you forsaken me? If you've been to the Commons in years past, you can go back and watch previous Easter sermons. I don't want to go too far down this path, but he was quoting an ancient poem, an ancient song, Psalm 22. And every Jewish child would have grown up with their mother singing this to them as they go to sleep, Psalm 22. They didn't have numbers back then, and you referred to a psalm by the first line of the psalm. So he was poetically, maybe even singing, some scholars think, singing out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was pointing back to a 1,000-year-old Jewish poem where a king of Israel, a former shepherd boy, was hurting and said, God, why have you forsaken me? I love it because it's human. Have you, any of you ever shaken your fists at the sky? I have. I can remember being on a wide open plain in Texas and screaming at the sky in anger at God. Why have you forsaken me? David, this ancient singer-songwriter, shepherd boy, king, he knew what that felt like. And what's beautiful is in his art, the lyrics of his poetry and song go on to tell us that God has never hidden his face from the afflicted one. You got to go read Psalm 22 later. That's why it's so beautiful that Jesus, the very face of God, was showing his full humanity on the cross, that he knows what it feels like to shake your fists at the heavens. When God's self was in a human body, that meant knowing what it feels like to feel abandoned by God. This is the end. This is the end of the life of a meteoric rise of a traveling ancient Near Eastern Messiah figure. Everybody thought just 6 days before this, as he rode into town and crowds were praising him and singing songs and throwing palm leaves down, that he was going to be their next president. He was going to overthrow Caesar. He was going to be the next Caiaphas or the high priest. They just know how it works. You got to be powerful if you want to change things. And instead, he wept and he washed feet and he sang ancient songs about God forsaking us, because Jesus was experiencing and embodying the death of God. Now, this is actually not a new idea. It's an ancient tradition within Christianity to wrestle with the idea of the death of God. And I think it's a powerful one, because what it empowers us to do, and this is what I want you to hear if you're feeling uncomfortable, it empowers all of us to let the God die that does not exist. One of the things that keeps drawing me back to Jesus is that Jesus shows me that God is not the God that he inherited. God was not a patriarchal, violent God. God was not the God that people thought God was, that was driven by power and politics and violence, just like we are projecting ourselves, as we talked about in Atheism for Lent, onto what we think God is. We have to let that God die. I want to flip over to John's gospel, because John says some beautiful things. This is just a short little sentence. It says the death of Jesus. This is in verse 30 of John 19. It says, when he had received this drink, this kind of vinegary mix of drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. I can tell you, because I'm a nerd theologian, for 2,000 years, there's been unending ink spilt on this sentence. There's this Greek word, tetelestai. John, the gospel author, wrote this word, tetelestai, and it means it is finished, or it means it is completed, or it means the fullness has come. It's just one of those words that you can talk about it and talk about it and talk about it. And Jesus said this ancient poem of forsakenness and pointed back to Psalm 22, and then he said, "It is finished." And then it says, he gave up his spirit. God died. Now, Easter is the good stuff. This is a Good Friday message, and this is why we got to rush through this. But if we don't let God die, then we can't let God be birthed anew. And we've spent the last 6 weeks, I hope, trying to destroy bad ideas about God. And the reason I feel so passionately about this is because bad ideas about God actually end up being bad realities for humans. Bad ideas about God become embodied as bad realities for humans. Because if we think God is a warring, violent God, if we think God is a patriarchal God, then all of a sudden men are empowered to continue to put women down. If we believe God is all about power instead of meekness, then men and women take power and use it to oppress and squish other people. If we believe that God is exclusive and only includes a small amount of people, then we are empowered to be exclusive and to leave people out. It becomes a very reality in our lives. We have to let bad ideas about God die. That's one of the aspects of the cross. But what happens after that? John chapter 19 turns into John chapter 20. It says this, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." John 20, verse 1 is really important in the history of understanding what happened historically, and more importantly, theologically or spiritually or earthly or humanly, because one of the things that's so shocking and beautiful about this is John, just like the other gospel authors, tell us that women are the ones who discovered the most shocking and important moment in the life of Jesus of Nazareth. Mary Magdalene, in this particular story, is named as the one who finds the empty tomb, and then she goes and tells John, who's the disciple whom Jesus loved, and Peter, the famous boys, the boys' club, and the early church called Mary Magdalene and the other women who discovered the resurrection the apostles to the apostles, because God chose women to be the ones to see that new life had come out of death. I want to skip down to this little interaction that happens later. They run to the tomb. They see it's empty. Mary goes running back to this, and then in verse 14 of John 20, it says, "At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, But she didn't realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" And I often point this out. This Greek word woman is a term of respect and honor. It's like, "Ma'am, who are you looking for?" Thinking he was a gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Mary was there because she thought she would put seasonings on the body. This would be part of the embalming process of a dead body. She didn't understand what was going on. And then Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Now, I sometimes am drawn more to stories in Scripture that are subtle, that are not extraordinary, like walking on water. To me, there's something more powerful and human about one deeply close friend relationship saying someone's name and then awakening something in them that resonates more with my experience of life. Have you ever had someone say your name and it was different than when other people said your name? I feel that when I read this story. She didn't even recognize Jesus. There's all sorts of literary, theological things going on here. John was an incredible genius as he wrote his gospel. He said she thought she was the gardener, and in this first century community who was oppressed themselves by a violent empire, they would have understood that he was referring to the original garden, that there's the story of intimacy in a garden with Adam and Eve, and everything went wrong in this ancient poem, which is not a poem about history or science, but it's a poem about all of us. And John is saying, we don't even recognize the garden. We don't even recognize the intimacy. We don't even recognize the fellowship, the oneness of being fully loved by God that we can experience. But then God said her name, Mary, and she turned. She said, "Teacher," which is also radical. Women weren't supposed to be taught back then. Jesus didn't care. He taught women. He educated them. He empowered them. He revealed the resurrection to them. They became the apostles to the apostles. One of the things that Easter is about is killing the idea that life is about patriarchy or the headship of men or anything where one gender has power over another gender. That's one aspect of Easter. I love that aspect. Now, when I was in my apologetic years, when I was more evangelical, when my experience of this was just to prove that this actually happened, I didn't even sometimes realize that what I was a part of was a late system that taught me that I had to believe perfectly that Jesus actually resurrected so that my soul could be saved, so that maybe I could partake in some future resurrection where I could be a part of heaven. And here's what I missed out on. This is one of the snakiest evil tricks that white European men have ever sneaked into our beautiful religion. Somewhere along the way, the powerful people who controlled religion realized that if they could make our entire faith about assenting or affirming a belief about something that happened in history so that maybe something in the future might go well for us, then it really doesn't matter what we actually do with our life right now. This is huge. We have to call it out. Most of American Christianity is grossly entangled in this lie. I have sat in the house of 100 millionaires in Dallas, Texas, who give ungodly amounts of money to seminaries to study apologetics, to prove that the resurrection happened so that they can go to churches and donate their tithe and be a part of a system where they feel no challenge whatsoever to their wealth. And the next day on Monday, they go back to work building their empire, oppressing their laborers who work for no living whatsoever, and they get wealthier and wealthier and are so excited they're going to go to heaven someday. And they are not affirming the resurrection. Here's a shocking thing for a pastor to say to you. I often, and maybe most of the time, don't affirm the resurrection. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is there are many times in my day where I don't even think about the horrific pain of what's happening in Gaza. Over 30,000 women, children, and men killed by bombs, starved to death, cut off from access to water. And if I deny that, I'm denying the resurrection. It really doesn't matter what I believe about what happened 2,000 years ago or what might happen in some future hypothetical time. What matters is if we affirm the resurrection right now. There have been rare moments in my life where I have affirmed the resurrection. There have been moments of love. And this is the thing that I want to invite us into that I think can be a challenge and also a conversation that might actually transform us. To me, this is the power of coming together. This is the power of opening scripture. This is the power of a living community, is when we willingly take the risk of a challenge. And my challenge is, can we collectively be the holy kind of atheist that stops believing in a God of patriarchy? Let that God die. That stops believing in a God of violence. Let that God die. That stops believing in a God of exclusion. Let that God die. That stops believing in God as a noun, and let's birth a God who is a verb. Let's stop believing in a God who is a being and participate in a God who is a way of being. See, my belief at the core is that we're a part of an ancient tradition that our ancestors from the Middle East have passed down, and it has threads of poetry and art that go back from thousands of years before Christ walked on this earth. And it's this ongoing conversation about who is God and what does it actually mean in our life. But the thing that I find so compelling is that resurrection, death, life, hope, all of the sacraments, all of the words we use are all in your body and in my body. And the only real value of religion, and this is what Jesus would say when he was shredding on religious leaders, is when it is transformative to bring about liberation and hope for the world, liberation for the oppressed and liberation for the oppressors. This whole journey we've been on thinking about what sort of thing God is, I want to bring us this Easter to the most simple, childlike, academically brilliant, unbelievably beautifully simple idea that God is love. It says it in scriptures multiple times. It's the lens through which we look through everything. And in Easter, we find it the most embodied, because we can let death happen to anything that is not love, and then we can birth into life what resurrection means. We can be the people who fight for the equality of women. We can, both men, women, non-binary. It doesn't even matter what your gender is. Let's just fight to make sure that gender is no longer something that oppresses people. We can make sure that we are a people who resurrect a type of community where your sexual orientation, your skin color, your differently labeled abilities, fill in the blank, the language you speak, the money that you have in your bank account, whatever it is, your level of education, nothing keeps anyone with a pulse and a beating human heart from experiencing the full and equal and powerful transformative love of God. That is affirming the resurrection. So we could, like most of modern Christianity, try to decide what we believe about the past or the future, if we affirm or deny something that happened at some point in time. Or really, really more interesting than that, we can decide if we're going to affirm resurrection in our bodies. Are we going to let some things die that hurt us? Easter is so powerful. Some of us have some relationships that need to die and need to be born anew. Some of us have some habits that need to die and a new way of being needs to be born. Some of us are actually oppressed and the system is crushing you and you need to be liberated with help from the outside. You might need financial help. You might need community to rescue you because you don't have anything you can do because the system is crushing you. So maybe what needs to die is our pride and like ask for help and let's find each other and let's power each other and let's be a real family and a real community. And that is what Easter is. I'm not sure I've ever figured out what pole vaulting is, but I've loved giving my life to figuring out why we do this Easter thing. And I gotta tell you, I love it. I'll get emotional because it's as I'm talking right now, I'm seeing your faces and I'm thinking of how much resurrection I've seen in your lives. I've seen so many of you pour your lives into children. I've seen so many of you show up at Black Lives Matter rally. I've seen so many of you fight for climate justice. I've seen so many of you who fight the legal system to support people. I've seen so many of you who create art that transforms our heart and takes us into deeper conversations. I see resurrection and life in your faces, and I want to thank you for that. We're going to come to the communion table today, as we always do, and I want to welcome you. We believe that this sacrament, just like baptism this morning or giving to the poor or any of the sacraments, is welcome to all, that Jesus meant it when he talked about a really big, expansive table. It's a feast for everyone. It's a performance art where we take these images, and it's particularly powerful on Easter because Jesus, in Holy Week, the last week of his life, had kind of one last family dinner, and it wasn't like Da Vinci's painting. It wasn't 12 men sitting around a table. Jesus would have had Mary Magdalene and all of his female disciples in the education system, and there would have been children around. It would have been a big church family having a big feast at the Last Supper, and he said, hey, remember me. And when Jesus says, remember me, this is not some sort of narcissistic thing. He always was talking about his way of being. He always was talking about this kingdom. And he was saying, remember this kingdom. Remember to love your enemies. Remember to love children. Remember to speak truth to power. Remember to liberate the oppressed. Remember that truth is the hope of the world. Remember that life and love and liberation are all in me. Take that into your body. And so when we take these elements, the bread and the wine represent the body of Christ. And to me, it's so powerful that when we take these things into our bodies, we're reminded that we are the resurrection. We are the resurrection. We are the resurrection. Let me pray over these elements, and we'll share this time together. God, I am so thankful that you recited that ancient poem on the cross. I'm thankful that you know what it feels like to feel abandoned. I'm thankful that you remind us of a promise that we could never be separate from you. I'm thankful that you are so much bigger than we could possibly imagine. I'm thankful that every conception I've had of you my entire life has been too small. I'm thankful that you're beyond being and ground of being and transcendence. I'm thankful that you are love. I'm thankful that I don't understand even yet fully what that word means. But God, I pray that this family and this community on this holy ancestral holiday, as we perform this sacrament together of taking these elements into our body, God, I pray that we will find you in us, Christ in us. I pray that we will remember the ancient orthodox truth of Christianity, that we are unconditionally loved, God, that we can be forgiven of our mistakes, and we can more importantly repent and change our minds and become more alive so that we can affirm resurrection by being the resurrection with you in us, a part of us. I pray that this will feel like a feast that connects us not only in our hearts closely and intimately, directly with you, but also with each other, because that's sort of the same thing. Thank you for the gift. Thank you for the community. Meet us in this space, in Jesus' name.
Come away with me in the night. Come away with me, and I write you a song. Come away with me on a bus. Come away where they can't tempt us with their lies. To come. come away with me in the kiss. On a mountaintop, come away with me, and I'll never stop loving you. If you'd like to stand with us, we're going to sing one last song together to close out our time.
The coming of the Lord. You are speaking truth to power. You are laying down my soul, replanting every vineyard till a brand new wine is poured. Your peace will quiet light. You are mothering and feeding in the wee hours of the night. Your gentle love is patient. You will never fade or tire. Your peace will make us. Dismantling our empires till each one of us is free, and your peace will make us one. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, your peace. your peace. Your peace will make us one.
So I want to thank you all again for being here. And I want to, every week we usually say the holiest time is when we leave these doors and go be resurrection or the community. And we also like to offer a place to go have dinner. Every week we go somewhere and hang out. But since it's Easter, we thought we'd encourage you to just go find some loved ones or friends to hang out. We're not going to have an organized place to go eat. But I would really encourage you to come back and be a part of this community, because we feel a real excitement and energy about empowering people in our community to be transformed and be resurrection, to make a real difference in individual lives and hearts, but also for our whole community and our whole world. So I want to really invite you to come be a part of it. And if you feel like you're on the outside looking in, I've been doing this for a long time, and I've had a lot of conversations. Some of you might have been coming here for 4 years, and you might feel like, I don't know that I feel that connected. Come ask us about that. We want to help you and support you in that way. Maybe you're new. Come up and talk to us. Ask questions, because we really, really believe the power of this family is in the pews right here. I also want to give a couple of thank yous. I'm super thankful for Jonathan this morning bringing out an easy up and fire pit, and Trey being in a fire pit. And I'm also thankful for all the people who are serving in childcare today. So if you have kids and you're picking them up, give them an extra thank you and a hug for giving up their Easter to love on your kids. I know they enjoy it and they love it, but let's do that for sure. I'm going to pray for us, and then we will go be together, and hopefully we will see you very, very soon. God, thank you for this family. Thank you for ancient traditions and sacraments and scriptures and the art of the music. But I'm most thankful just for the breath in this room of the individuals next to us. We believe that you're relational and that you're in our relationships with each other. Draw us close to one another and let that bring a lot of love and change. Thank you for Easter and resurrection and hope and life. In Jesus' name, amen.